Hi everyone. A lot of you have been submitting YouTube comments, and a lot of you guys have questions on prostate cancer that you would like us to ask Dr. Scholz. And today, we're going to answer those questions. So our next question, I think I've seen this question come in at least 200 times, and it makes sense to me, and I look forward to this day. But when are we going to see prostate cancer diagnosis via imaging and without biopsies?
Well, it may come within the next 10 years. Dr. Klotz shared a video looking at microRNAs in the urine, and it looked very accurate. That could be out, who knows, 2 to 4 years. These new PSMA PET scans light up specifically for cancer. So if someone was unable to go through a biopsy, he could have a PSMA PET scan. And if there's nothing lighting up in the prostate, it's a very strong indication there's no prostate cancer present. The biopsies are still attractive, of course, because it gives you the grade of the cancer. And that's an important distinction for what kind of treatment you need.
With everything you talked about and the developments of imaging, do you think that we'll see maybe, if they are going to do biopsies, we'll just see a complete lack of randomized biopsies and just do targeted biopsies with this imaging?
Well, I think we can do targeted biopsies now in 2020. There's a lot of momentum from the past. Random biopsies have been standard for 30 years. It's the lingua franca of the prostate cancer world. So I don't know when we'll finally move beyond doing random biopsies in everybody, but I don't see it happening immediately, probably not within the next 5 years, hopefully someday.
I look forward to it. I'll never forget reopening up the Wall Street Journal and seeing you talking about randomized biopsies and talking about like harpooning the prostate. So
they are very large bore needles, and they about 1 in 100 men is hospitalized afterwards with a life-threatening infection when everything is done properly. When the biopsy is done improperly, the infection rates are even higher.
It's on the same topic, but this is a question from me because I get this at Helpline a lot and I'd like to hear your answer. Do you think that biopsy, when they're doing the biopsies and they're taking the tissue out, that could cause the cancer to spread in the body?
It doesn't seem very likely. The question comes up all the time and there have been concerns about it. They can actually show cancer cells in the bloodstream after biopsies and after radical prostatectomies. But people forget that the cancer just getting out of the gland is not what translates into metastasis. It has to do with the genetic makeup of the cancer cells themselves and their capacity to land somewhere, put down roots, and then grow in a foreign environment in a different part of the body. And those are the important aspects of the cancer, not whether or not it gets outside the prostate, but whether it has the genetic capacity to grow in a distant part of the body. And so, it's well documented that with a biopsy or with a radical prostatectomy that there are numerous cancer cells that get out, but they don't reproduce.
I do have a question. I had an undetectable PSA for 1 year post-open surgery, and then I had a 0.11, so 0.11 and PSA, and then 3 months later, a 0.2. I'm going to be beginning radiation therapy in a week. And my question is, they are going to just radiate the prostate bed. Then if the PSA still goes up, they're going to hit the lymph nodes. I trust my doctors, but I want your opinion on whether the lymph nodes should be treated at the same time.
Well, we don't have enough information. We don't know how old they are. We don't know what their Gleason score was. There's always a consideration in this modern era for treating the lymph nodes at the same time, because studies show that there's no additional side effects. So there's a temptation to be more thorough and cover the area not only where the prostate used to be, but also the surrounding lymph nodes. But there's so many unanswered questions here. We don't know very many details about this individual. And another question would be, does this person need to get a short course of hormone treatment with his radiation? Should they go get a PSMA PET scan? There's just a lot of different angles now that we really can't address. But there's no right or wrong answer. There are certainly cases where it's reasonable to just radiate where the prostate used to be, see how things go, and God forbid it comes back again or the PSA doesn't drop, get a PSMA PET scan, find out where it is in some other part of the body, and then radiate that spot. Even when you have all the information, it's not always entirely clear what the best pathway forward is. But those are some of the considerations.
We have one, somebody in the comment section who's having a hard time finding a doctor who does brachytherapy. And I know that you've done a lot of research and they can contact PCRI for helping them find that. But my question is, why is brachytherapy not really a popular radiation treatment in all of the span of, you know, the other radiations?
It seems that the primary reason is that the doctors who do it are paid so much less than the doctors that do other type of radiation. I believe Medicare is going to try and rectify this in 2021 and bring the reimbursement rates for brachytherapy up on par with other types of radiation. And I think you'll see a huge resurgence because the clinical research that's been done shows that brachytherapy cure rates are higher or highest of all the different types of treatments. So it is economical, convenient, and effective, and certainly no more toxic. So brachytherapy should be a consideration whenever people are talking about treating prostate cancer. And once they start paying the brachytherapists a fair rate, the insurance companies, you know, set these rates, then you're going to see a big resurgence in brachytherapy over the next 5-10 years.
All right, so our next question is, I'm on abiraterone, but my PSA is increased from 37 from 20. Can Nubeqa now be a treatment?
So when someone is resistant to Zytiga, which sounds like this person is, there's a small chance that second generation hormone therapies like Nubeqa, Erleada, and Xtandi will be effective. But the chances for success are only about 10-15% of the patients. However, it's still reasonable to try it because these medicines are well tolerated, and usually within 60 days, you'll see if the PSA stabilizes or starts dropping. So I think it's okay to start Nubeqa, but also plans need to be made. If the Nubeqa is not working, what is the next step?
Thank you so much for watching. If you would like Dr. Scholz and I to cover one of your questions, you can go ahead and leave them in the comment section of this YouTube video or on our other videos, and we can go ahead and pick them up from there. Also, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. The subscribe button's right here on the right. We come up with new prostate cancer videos every week, and visit our website, pcri.org, if you would like more information. We hope you have a great week.